I'm Christy Mercer. I'm a professor in the philosophy department and also chair of literature humanities. I'm really very pleased to have a chance to bring together two separate parts of the core, literature humanities and art humanities. Our hope today was to, you know, start building connections between the text and some of the materials of art humanities and literature humanities. And I'm really, really very thankful to our two professors who have agreed to help us out in this experiment. We have Professor Deborah Steiner from the Classics Department. Now, Professor Steiner has published in a number of lit hummy kinds of materials. She has a book on the Iliad. She's written articles on the Symposium. She has, one of her books is, I like this title, Images in Mind, Statues in Archaic and Classical Greek Literature and Thought. So Debbie, Professor Steiner represents, I think, not just literature humanities, but treating ancient materials from a visual perspective. Professor Francesco De Angelis is from the Art History Department. He was a professor at the Roman Art and Archaeology, the German Archaeology Institute in Rome. He's also taught in Pisa. In short, he's one of these astonishingly erudite and international scholars. We're very, very pleased to have him here at Columbia. He's taught in art humanities and often gives the lecture that is given on the Parthenon to people who are teaching on the Parthenon in art humanities. So they're going to do a kind of dynamic duo routine here. They've been teaching a course on together, and apparently that's worked very, very well. I've heard rave reviews about that course. So what's going to happen is Professor Steiner is going to talk for a little while, and then Professor De Angelis will take over, and then we'll have a short time for Q&A. Now, one more, let me just offer an advertisement for something. As I hope all of you have had a chance to look at the LitHum website, one of the points of the website is to include images and materials both from art humanities but also from music humanities. And one of the things we're going to be doing in the spring is we will announce a competition for what we're calling core essays. There'll be two essays that are particularly interesting to you. One is called Core Theme Essay, and the other will be called Core Connection Essay. These are essays that students can write based on papers for their art hum class, their lit hum class, their music hum class, where, and for the core theme essay, it can just be on a theme that's related to one, to something they've been working on in any one of the core courses. But a core connection essay will attempt to connect ideas and issues from a work in one of the core courses to a work in another core course. So in a way, this lecture today exemplifies the kind of cross-core connections that we're going to encourage students to make. In the spring, there'll be a committee formed of students who will vet these essays. And then if you get your essay accepted, you'll be called a core scholar, which I hope sounds somewhat exciting. And you actually have your essay put on the web, and we're going to try to have a printed version of that as well. So I'm hoping that this lecture today, for those of you who are so inclined, will be a bit of an inspiration to think about how to connect up materials in one part of the core with materials in the other. So I'm happy to give you Professor Steiner.
Alert you to the fact that this is something of an experiment. We decided rather at the last minute that it would be more entertaining to you if instead of just dividing it half and half, we did it more as a dialogue. So we're going to be going back and forth. We haven't rehearsed. I almost didn't make it in this morning because of New Jersey Transit, so it's very impromptu, and we're very open to questions at the end. So I'd like to invite you to think yourself out of this Altschul Auditorium and to think yourself back into late 5th century. There's a man running around the streets of Athens, really desperate to find out what happened more than a decade ago. What happened on an evening in Athens in the winter of 416 BC. His name is Glaucon, and this is the scene that Plato presents at the beginning of the symposium. And he's running around Athens trying to find out about this dinner party at which a notorious individual was present, an individual by the name of Alcibiades. Now, Alcibiades was perhaps the most beautiful, the most gifted, the richest young man in Athens of his time. Absolutely notorious for good and for ill. The people adored him and they hated him. They couldn't get enough of him. He'd entered no fewer than 7 chariots in the Olympic Games, the most expensive sport, and he carried off victory in all 7. He went into battle holding a shield with the blazon of Eros on it. He had many lovers, both male and female. On one occasion, apparently, he cut off the tail of his dog. And when asked why he'd done so, he replied, "So that the Athenians talk about that and don't say anything worse of me." Well, Alcibiades was there at this dinner party. And Glaucon is so anxious to discover what happened that night, because Alcibiades is the man of the moment in 404, when the text, supposedly, when the opening scene of the text occurs. Now, by 404, Athens had been involved in a long and very unhappy war. The Peloponnesian War, Athens had been at war with Sparta and its allies for almost 30 years. And its once invincible army and navy, greatest army and navy that Greece had ever seen, had suffered a series of crushing defeats. Alcibiades had been involved in the Peloponnesian War. He had actually been quite a successful general on another number of occasions. However, he'd fallen out of favor with the Athenian people after being unjustly blamed for a defeat. His excellent military advice had been rejected, and out of pique, he left Athens, went into a kind of voluntary exile in Asia Minor, and offered his services to the Persian king, once Athens' great enemy. Well, Athens was consumed with the question of should they recall him. As I said, they both loved him and hated him. He was regarded in 404 as the one individual capable of saving Athens, which was really falling apart at this point. Financially exhausted, it had gone through a series of terrible political upheavals, factionalism in the city, everything going wrong. Could Alcibiades save the day? Well, Alcibiades never got a chance to save the day. He was assassinated in 404, quite probably in a political conspiracy. His killer was sent out by the Persian king. We don't know exactly why. It's very probable that the individual who's seeking information about this dinner party is doing so because we're in the period when Athens is debating hotly whether Alcibiades should be recalled or immediately after his death. Now, in Plato's depiction of this dinner party, and it's an imaginary dinner party, it supposedly took place to celebrate a great victory won by the tragedian Agathon. He carried off the prize in a dramatic festival about which we'll be talking later on. And like any Oscar winner today, he was having a party to celebrate his victory. And Alcibiades was one of his guests. Now, as Plato paints this party, which gathers together some of the most prominent intellectuals and future politicians and playwrights of Athens, including Aristophanes and Socrates, we see at this dinner party the seeds of the disaster that are going to claim not just Alcibiades, that we can see what went wrong and what culminated in this ignominious death. Now, what Professor De Angelis and I are going to be doing today is trying to alert you to the fact that in many ways the text is not comprehensible when removed from the visual milieu surrounding its original audience. For those of us who are removed by many, many centuries from 5th century Athens, we have laboriously to recreate this visual milieu, the images, the statues that fill the streets and private homes, the vase paintings on the pottery that the Athenians used in their everyday life, their temple sculptures, and so forth and so on. This text is filled with statues and paintings. And what we want to do to you, for you is to trace out that strand and to show how text and image work simultaneously. We're going to be breaking our presentation into 5 parts and doing a kind of back and forth. I'll be saying a few words about the nature of the symposium, what a symposium is, and Professor De Angelis will be illustrating that. And then moving on to talk about some of the public sculpture in Athens. I'll then be detailing 4 points in the text and drawing on Professor De Angelis at various points to talk about the relevant visual imagery. We'll be looking at a moment very early on in the text where Socrates gets left behind by his companion, where they haven't yet got to the dinner party, and Socrates stands on a neighbor's porch. What is he doing there? We'll then look at one of the many speeches that were delivered on this occasion, and that Plato supposedly reproduces. As I say, this is all fictional. He's making this up. Then we'll turn to the arrival of Alcibiades at this dinner party, a disruptive, drunken presence, so drunk he has to be half carried in. And finally, we'll turn to the speech that Alcibiades delivers almost at the end of the text. So first of all, the symposium. It's not a dinner party. That's a misnomer. What a symposium means is a drinking together. And drink defines the symposium. The food aspect is not important. You would consume your meal quite quickly, the tables would be cleared, and the mixing bowl brought on. Wine is what the symposium is all about. In fact, so important is that wine element that at these drinking parties, you would elect a so-called symposiarch, the leader of the symposium. And his duty was to determine the ratio of wine to water. The Greeks never drank their wine undiluted. That was reserved for barbarians, for those imaginary, constantly drunk creatures, the satyrs, and for other uncouth individuals. The civilized Greek diluted their wine with water. Now, obviously, the degree to which you dilute your wine is going to determine how inebriated you get. And on this occasion, everyone is very hungover. Why are they hungover? They're hungover because this is actually the second night of celebration. There was the official celebration of Agathon's dramatic victory at a winter theater festival. All performances of drama in Athens were in the context of religious festivals on behalf of Dionysus. We'll be coming back to him later on. And they were competitions with winners for the best tragedy or comedy or satyr play. And the winner, or rather the producer of the winning play, would host a victory banquet on behalf of the poets and the actors immediately following the proclamation of the victory in the theater. But Agathon's dinner party or drinking party happens the night after. It's a more private celebration. And everyone is so drunken and hungover from the night before that they can't stand the thought of spending another night in heavy drinking. So it's going to be a sober affair, only one part of wine and 10 parts of water. And sobriety is also going to be maintained by their banishing the flute girls and the courtesans. And this brings me to a second aspect of the symposium. It is an all-male gathering. No respectable woman would ever set foot at a symposium. In fact, it takes place in a set of rooms called the men's rooms, the men's quarters in the private home, or occasionally in a public building. And the only women who would be there would be prostitutes who doubled as flute girls, and also more high-class courtesans, like a Japanese geisha girl, who was valued for her ability not only to lend sophistication and beauty to the occasion, but also to entertain. Now, we know from our architectural remains that these men's quarters were rooms rectangular in shape, and couches would be around the perimeters of the room. As you know, the Greeks reclined when they dined and when they drank. There would be between 7 and 15 couches, two men to a couch. There's a lot of byplay concerning who gets to lie next to who, the reasons that will become very clear in a minute. And they would form a kind of circle around the parameters of the room, 14 to 30 people in all. So a very intimate gathering. Everyone would know one another, and central to that space, that symposic space, would be the crater, the jar where the wine was mixed with water. This was an egalitarian occasion, no one privileged above the rest. That's what distinguishes it from the Homeric type of feast. And the wine cup would circulate from one guest to the other. This was also an occasion for displays of erudition, of wit and wisdom, because not only would you have professional entertainers, not just your courtesans, but also perhaps a poet or buffoons brought in to perform acrobatics and so forth and so on. Kind of paid clowns would be there as well on occasion, dancers brought in. But much of the entertainment was supplied by the guests themselves. As the wine cup circulated, so too you would give your party piece, you would deliver a speech, you would perform a song, and this was a competitive activity. You want to outdo your neighbor. You want to match his contribution and go one better. And we'll see this agonistic strain very powerfully in Plato's account of Agathon's symposium. Now, the final element I wanted to alert you to is the pederastic element. I don't need to underscore how much of Plato's Symposium is about pederastic love. The love between an older man and a younger man, or a man and a boy. And of course, it is rather foreign to us today to regard this as a mainstream aspect of Greek culture. It absolutely was. And of course, who you got to lie next to on the couch was a very important aspect. And I'm going to turn things over at this point as you see on the screen an image of two individuals reclining.
Well, yes. You can also see how the variety of occupations with which participants in a symposium were engaged. For example, you can see them not only flirting with each other, but also playing music and drinking, of course, playing games, for example, aiming at a target with the last drops of wine left in your cup, singing like this one is doing, or arriving late, as Alcibiades does, and as these two friends are doing, they are arriving preceded by a flute player. They are arriving to the symposium, and you see there are still two places that are free on the couches. And the last element I wanted to point out is the waiter, the big mixing vessel for wine. Well, Professor Steiner has beautifully described the historical background of Plato's symposium. What I want to do now is briefly sketch out the monumental and artistic background to this text. And a background which is emblematically incarnated by a monument many of you are already familiar with, and all of you are going to be familiar with soon, namely the Parthenon, the main temple of Athens, dedicated to the patron goddess of the city, Athena, built in 15 years after the mid 5th century BCE, a temple that was the symbol of the political and cultural supremacy of the Athenians, or at least of their claim to this supremacy. A temple that was lavishly decorated with figural sculpture on the pediments, on the tablature, on the top of the wall, of the walls of the inner chamber. And this was an extremely bold project. Because what the Athenians tried to do here was to visually render the perfection of the bodies of their own gods. They did so through a combination of naturalism, that is, of close observation of details of nature, of the anatomies, of the draperies and the folds, and of idealization, that is, removal of every defect, every blemish, everything, every imperfection. This is not only visible in the proportions of the limbs, in the accuracy with which the anatomies render, but also in the postures of the gods, who are represented in their dynamism and energy, or as in the cases you see here on the screen, in their state of relaxation and ease, as in the case of Dionysus, the god of wine, who's lying on his panther skin, displaying his magnificent, nude, and well-trained body, or as in the case of Aphrodite, the goddess of love, who is represented in this languorous posture, succumbing to the force of her own power, reclining in the lap of this other goddess, while exposing part of her shoulder, and with the garment that that follows softly the contours of her breasts, of her lap, of her glorious legs. The agenda of the Athenians was even bolder, because not only did they represent the gods in this way, they claimed that they themselves were as perfect as the gods, as beautiful as the gods. And this can be very well seen if we compare images from different parts of the Parthenon. For example,
image of the young god Apollo sitting amidst his divine colleagues. And one of the Athenian youths that participate in the cavalry parade occupies a large part of the frieze of the Parthenon. If we compare the heads, for example, here Apollo and here the youth, they look like each other. There is no difference between the one and the other, save for a difference in scale. And this was not just an aesthetic play, it was also an extremely strong political statement. It was a statement about democracy being able to raise the citizens, the Athenian citizens, to the level of the gods. The underlying notion here is the idea of democracy as leveling upwards rather than downwards. So every Athenian was like every other Athenian, and all the Athenians together were like their own gods.
Now the impact, the aesthetic impact of the Parthenon sculptures is so strong that we usually tend to forget what incredible amount of energy had to be invested in such a project. Because, of course, the Athenians were not beautiful. At least most of them were not as beautiful as the frieze of Parthenon claimed to be. So you have to imagine what amount of faith and self-awareness and self-consciousness must have been put into this project, which was an almost inhuman project, because living up to the standards set by the Parthenon was an incredibly difficult thing. And as a matter of fact, the history would soon uncover the delusional character of this project. Professor Steiner has mentioned the Peloponnesian War, which started a couple of years after the Parthenon was finished. This Peloponnesian War, which saw Athens on the losing side at the end. A war that obviously coincided with the outbreak of a plague. A plague that is famously described by Thucydides, and in his account of the history of the Peloponnesian War. And I would like now to read the passage from Thucydides' account, because Thucydides insists on the physical consequences of the plague. And he displays the same attentive, accurate gaze that the artists of the Parthenon reserved for the reserved to the bodies of the gods and of the Athenian citizens on the temple. There is a difference, though. I've talked about the idealizing tendencies of the Parthenon sculptures. In the case of the citizens, we have a realistic tendency. Thucydides is not trying to beautify reality, and actually he is describing all the ugly sides of reality. So please keep an eye on these sculptures while I read. It was said, and now I'm going to Thucydides, it was said that the plague had broken out in many places previously in the neighborhood of Lemnos and elsewhere. But the pestilence of such extent and mortality was nowhere remembered. Neither were the physicians at first of any service, ignorant as they were of the proper way to treat it. But they died themselves the most quickly, as they visited the sick most often. Nor did any human art succeed any better. Supplications in the temples, divinations, and so forth were found equally futile, till the overwhelming nature of the disaster at last put a stop to them altogether. As a rule, there was no ostensible cause for the sickness. But people in good health were all of a sudden attacked by violent heats in the head, and redness, and inflammation in the eyes, the inward parts, such as the throat and tongue becoming bloody, and emitting a natural and fetid breath.
These symptoms were followed by sneezing and hoarseness, after which the pain soon reached the chest and produced a hard cut. When it fixed in the stomach, it upset, and discharges of bile of every kind named by physicians and students, accompanied by very great distress. In most cases, also an effectual retching followed, producing violent spasms, which in some cases ceased soon after and others much later. Externally, the body was not very hot to the touch, nor pain in its appearance, but reddish, livid, and breaking out into small pustules and ulcers. But internally, it burned so that the patient could not bear to have on him clothing or linen, even of the very slightest description, or indeed to be otherwise than stark naked. Stark naked, the same nakedness that we see on the Parthenon, but turned into the negative. What they would have liked best would have been to throw themselves into cold water, as indeed was done by some of them, by some of the neglected sick, who plunged into the rain tanks in their agonies of unquenchable thirst, though it made no difference whether they drank little or much. Besides this, the miserable feeling of not being able to rest or sleep never ceased to torment them. Never being able to rest, just what the gods are doing here. The body, meanwhile, did not raise the weight so long as this temper was at its height, but held out for moral against its ravages, so that when they succumbed, as in most cases, on the seventh or eighth day to the internal inflammation, they had still some strength in them. But if they passed this stage and the disease descended further into the bowels, inducing a violent ulceration there, accompanied by severe diarrhea, this brought on a weakness which was generally fatal. For the disorder first settled in the head, ran its course from thence through the whole of the body, and even when it did not prove mortal, it still left its mark on the extremities. For it settled in the private parts, the fingers and the toes, and many escaped with velocity, some too with that of their eyes. An aggravation of the existing calamity was the influx from the country to the city, and this was especially felt by the new arrivals. As there were no houses to receive them, they had to be lodged at the hot season of the year in stifling cabins, where the mortality rate without restraint. The bodies of dying men lay one upon another. And how the creatures read about the streets and gather around old fountains in their longing for water. The sacred places also in which they had quartered themselves were full of corpses, of persons that had died there, just as they were. For as the disaster passed for months, men, not knowing what was to become of them, became utterly careless of everything, whether sacred or profane. So, as you see, under the very eye of the gods, whose bodies they had tried to represent, and with whom they had attempted to identify, lay the corpses of the real Athenians. And this must have forced the Athenians to measure the distance between the divine world and the human world, between idealization and reality. But the most remarkable thing was the reaction of the Athenians. Instead of renouncing their ideals, their aspirations, they carried them even further. And indeed, as a matter of fact, it is in these years, in the years of the Peloponnesian War, that some of the most sensuous and most aesthetically compelling images of great art were made, such as in the case of this figure here, figure of victory, a very apposite figure for an age of war. Victory, who's balancing on one foot, trying to adjust her sandal, displaying her body in the process. Again, we see this Aphrodite motif of the shoulder strap that slides down. You see the belly beneath this in the breast under this very thin garment. You can follow the curves of the legs, and this is extremely remarkable because here victory is made desirable, is presented as being desirable in a very concrete physical sense. It is as if the Athenians were striving for victory, not only with all their forces, with all their senses, as it were, in an attempt to contrast the precariousness of coeval life. So it is against. It is not by chance that the paper stages, the text stages, the symposium, precisely in these years, which were also the years of his youth, by the way. I mean, you must imagine being 20 in the Athens of the Peloponnesian War must have been an incredibly exciting experience, if risky, of course. And it is on this background of increased sensorial awareness, of sharpened sensitivity, of acuteness of feeling, that we can appreciate properly not only the choice of theme of the symposium, love and beauty, but also and especially its intensity. And it is only against this background that we start to understand why Plato had to invest so much energy, so much rhetorical, poetic energy, to move beyond a purely physical understanding of eros, of love, and go towards a more sublimated, an intellectual notion of love, as love of wisdom, as a philosophy.
And at this point, I think I can turn things back to you.
Okay, well, many of the themes that Professor Angelis has touched on will be coming back to, not least the attempt to reach the gods, which is what Socrates does in no uncertain way in his speech. Also the theme of victory, which is absolutely integral to this occasion. Also, the whole idea of the body and the body beautiful. And it's with the reverse of the body beautiful that I'm going to begin, as I ask you to think about a moment at the very start of the text. Now, Socrates has been invited to Agathon's dinner party. And a character by the name of Aristodemus comes along just as Socrates is preparing to depart. He's quite astonished by Socrates' appearance, because as you'll be seeing later on, Socrates is notoriously ugly. But he's made an attempt to beautify himself. For this occasion, he's going to the home of a very beautiful man, a member of Athens' jeunesse dorée at the time. So what has he done? He's taken a bath and he's put on some fancy sandals. Sandals, as you can see here, are an important element of your toilette, both male and female. Wearing fancy sandals is a way of getting your man in Aristophanes Lysistrata, and it also characterizes this beautiful figure of victory here. Well, Socrates too has put on fancy sandals. Is he going out to be the seducer, or maybe the seduced? Well, that's left an open question. But poor Aristodemus, who is not a member of the elite, has not been invited to Agathon's party. And Socrates says, well, come along nonetheless. And Aristodemus says, well, you know, I haven't really been invited. It's been embarrassing, so forth and so on. Socrates says, it's okay. You come with me. And you were allowed to bring along a friend. A symposium wasn't by invitation only, but you had to have someone who vouched for you. Now, on that image that Professor De Angelis showed, you saw the individual arriving late at the party. And this is what Socrates is going to do. He and Aristodemus set out through the streets of Athens, and the ultimate embarrassment claims poor Aristodemus. All of our worst nightmares is to show up at a party where nobody knows us, and the person who's supposed to introduce us isn't there anymore. Well, what has happened to Socrates? Socrates, we're told, has fallen behind He's taken up his stance on a neighbor's porch. He's standing there on the porch, and the text spells out very clearly that he's standing there immobile. Now, what would Socrates look like? Well, for a 5th and 4th century audience, it would be very clear. There was only one type of image that stood regularly on porches. It was a so-called herm, one of these quadrilateral blocks of stone. Now, you've just seen those images on the Parthenon, those amazing Olympians showing their muscles, ephebic, glorious bodies. Remember that the Athenians also worshipped their gods in the form of these more primitive images, what we call aniconic or semi-iconic images, barely anthropomorphized. What distinguishes the herm is the human head and the upright phallus. These are ipiphallic, it's a symbol of virility, and herms, as their name suggests, are dedicated to the god Hermes. Now, Hermes is ubiquitous in classical Athens. Hermes, as you know, is the god of boundaries. He is, in a typical paradox in Greek religion, both the boundary crosser and the one who demarcates. A few of Hermes' epithets give you this sense. Don't worry about the names, just the idea of boundaries is the important point. He's Hermes Prophylaios, Hermes before the gate, Hermes Enodios, Hermes on the road, because the road moves you from one place to the other. Hermes, god of thieves, because what the thief does is he turns mine into yours and yours into mine. And my favorite of all, which is Hermes Strophios, which is Hermes of the hinge, of the door hinge, the hinge which separates inside from out. And when you erected a herm on your porch, you were signifying the division between public and private space, between inside and outside. These were guardian images, they were apotropaic, they could put the evil eye on you if you attempted to mess about with the property, and that upright phallus is in itself a challenge and a threat. Hermes is the god who passes between all realms. Hermes Psychopompos leads the souls down to the dead. But the herm, independent of Hermes, had a particular standing in 5th and 4th century Athens. We know that although, according to some accounts, herms were first erected in Athens by a tyrant, they rapidly became associated with the more radical democracy that came into place in the second half of 5th century Athens. And we know, because we know this association between the herm and democracy and the populist aspect of this type of monument, from a number of sources. Not only were these quadrilateral blocks very easily reproducible, they were cheap, you could just make them in the hundreds and they existed in the hundreds, but we also have a record of a victory that the Athenians won when they were pursuing their war against Persia in the earlier part of the 5th century. And Athens, at this point, had taken over leadership of the Greek forces who were taking the war into Persian territory, and they had captured a Persian city by the name of Ion, and they proposed erecting 4 herms in Athens to celebrate this victory. Well, the generals, the Athenian generals, wanted their names inscribed on the herms. The people wouldn't let them. The assembly voted against them. There was to be no particularization of glory. Glory was to belong to the fighting men as a whole. And we have a record of the inscription on these herms, and it does indeed talk about the people of Athens as having acquired the glory that glory that was formerly reserved for the members of the elite. Now, why would Plato introduce poems into his text? And there's a lot of joking going on with the language, where everyone keeps wanting Agathon to send a servant to go move Socrates from his position, and the verb that's used to move also means to put in motion sexually. Are we going to arouse Socrates? Are we going to make him into a lover? But the important point for us is Alcibiades' involvement with Hermes. Now, just as Athens was about to launch a great naval expedition against Sicily in 412, putting together the greatest armada, the greatest naval fleet Greece had ever seen, lavishing thousands of drachma on outfitting these warships. And the period before, right before you set out on a campaign or an expedition, was a very charged moment. If anything inauspicious happened, if anything unusual happened, if a cow was born with two heads or women miscarried, that was considered an evil omen and to portend ill for that expedition. Well, just before this expedition was launched and Alcibiades was supposed to be one of the leaders, there was, we think, a symposium, dinner party. Young men got very drunk and they participated in what we'll be illustrating a bit later on, the so-called commos, when the inebriated guest would spill out into the streets and not infrequently commit acts of vandalism and hooliganism. We have several court cases in which young men are accused of committing acts of violence following these kinds of drunken fraternity parties. So out they went into the streets, and what did they do? They mutilated the Huns. They cut them on their faces and on their bodies. And Alcibiades was named as one of the leaders of this prank. We don't know whether he was guilty or not, but the Athenian people turned against him, and they saw in this not just a youthful misdemeanor and someone who couldn't hold their drink. They saw in it an attack on the democracy. They thought that Alcibiades was aiming at a tyranny. And one rather interesting detail that Aristophanes, who's among the guests at the dinner party, tells us in one of his comedies in the Lysistrata, although it's not in more sober accounts of events, he suggests that the mutilators of the Huns not only cut their faces and their bodies, they actually castrated them. And what we're going to see later on in the text is Alcibiades' desire to penetrate Socrates, to get hold of him both sexually and in an intellectual sense, to derive wisdom from him, but also to have his way with him. And in his frustration at Socrates' imperviousness, Socrates' stoniness, Socrates' emotion, immovability, he went out, perhaps several years later, and mutilated these herbs instead. But I want to leave that moment in the text and turn now to Agathon's speech. And what we are showing on the screen is an image of Eros with, in the midst of consummating a sexual relationship. And I'll be coming back to this image in a moment. Now, what I want to alert you to, as I previously suggested, is that in order to make sense of the speeches at the symposium, we need to know that these dining halls were filled with painted pottery. every wine cup, every mixing bowl, every wine jug, and there were multiplicities of vessels used at the symposium. If you've ever seen a Greek wine cup, they're shallow, round dishes with narrow stems. Try and drink out of one. It actually takes a great deal of dexterity and sophistication to use and not to spill it. Uncouth drinkers, satyrs, barbarians, use drinking horns. They guzzle their wine. The sophisticated, urbane drinker uses one of these cups, decorated with wonderful images. And among perhaps some of our best painted images come from sympotic pottery. This is when our artists would pull out the stops, knowing that they were painting for a very rich clientele who would pay a high price to have a piece of beautiful tableware at their symposium. And even in the image that we earlier showed of the symposium, you noticed the wine cups that were there. These would have decorations around their surfaces. They would also have decorations in the interior. And as you drain the cup, this interior image would come clear. And many of the images show Eros. Eros in a variety of activities, often engaged in athletic pursuits. If we could just see a very famous image from the 4th century by the sculptor Lysippus, which shows Eros in the act of stringing the bow. So you see Eros as an athlete, you see him engaged in victory celebrations, crowning musical and athletic victors, you see him engaged in an amorous hunt. He basically performs all the activities that the elite of Athens would perform. And Agathon's speech describes Eros as youthful, delicate, beautiful, flowery. Some of these images show Eros carrying a tendril or another plant. They show him as young, a barely ephebic boy, prepubescent, little musculature. He is never bearded. As soon as you grow a beard in Greek thinking, you cease to be an object of desire to other men. That is the turning point when you turn from being a beloved to being a love, from being an object of desire to being the one who pursues that object of desire. It's also clear from Agathon's speech that Eros is winged, and I just wanted to spend a few moments pointing out the integral connection, which you already saw with that image of victory, between wings and desire. There's no need to spell out how integral the idea of rising aloft is to sex, but the Greeks took this idea much further. Practically every divinity or monster who engages in the pursuit of maidens, but more particularly younger men, is winged. Eos, the goddess of dawn, when Zeus abducts Ganymede, the most beauteous Trojan youth, he sends his eagle to do so. Boreas, the north wind, who abducts nymphs, is winged. The harpies, the sphinxes, the sirens, they're all winged, and they lift up young boys, and they consummate sex aerially, if we could go back to that other image. And you see this mid-air consummation. Aphrodite herself is often mounted on a winged bird, on a goose, on a swan. And the first kind of expression of this is what the Greeks depicted as a phallus bird, an upright phallus, with little eyes like a bird and wings. So this really brings together the two spheres. And as Agathon performs his speech, we have to imagine the space of the symposium filled with images like this, filled with cups and jars and jugs that inspire desire, that give you an object of desire to feast your eyes on, because often the evening would end with everyone going off to sleep with their individual partners, whether one of those prostitutes, one of those courtesans, their own wives at home if they were married men, or perhaps one of the youthful wine pourers who was in attendance at the feast. But the point I wanted to end with before handing things back to Professor De Angelis is the paradox of Eros. Eros is at once the object of desire and the lover. And this is a theme absolutely central to the speech of Diotima in the Symposium, and integral to the confusion that surrounds the figure of Socrates. Is he Eros the lover? Is he the object of love? As I mentioned, Eros is represented as a beauteous youth, exactly the type of individual who would be pursued. His wings give him the fleetness to escape pursuit, because Eros in the Greek imagination is always the pursuit of the absent beloved. It's all about trying to get that beloved rather than the moment of consummation itself. But he also instantiates the feeling of desire. To be overwhelmed by Eros is to fall prey to desire, to feel your heart, as our Greek poets tell us, winged, a flutter, to go off in pursuit yourself. Well, at this point, we're going to switch off again, and Professor De Angelis is going to take you into that next stage of the symposium that I mentioned, that moment when it spills out of the confines of the dining quarters and goes into the streets.
Very brilliant. You will see an example of Comus here on this page, and what I wanted to underscore on this page is the fact that there's a difference between the postures of the participants in the symposium and the same participants in the Comus. In the symposium, the participants are lying on their couches. They're not moving, whereas in the case of the Comus, they had stood up, they started dancing, moving in various ways, making jokes, singing, and doing worse things as it occurred. And it is a way for the Athenian base painters not only to represent a significant moment of Athenian social life, but also to display their own mastery, their own command of postures, of perspectival rendering of these postures. And we have several images of the Comus. But of course,
the borderline between the ecstatic frenzy of drunkenness and the less palatable aspects of the same drunkenness is, as you don't know, not yet at least, is a very thin one, and it was often crossed. Experiences like vomiting, feeling sick, and so on are also often represented on bases. And this leads us to an important point that is important also in Plato's text, that is self-control, moderation, restraint. Because it is those who drink too much who are unable to to limit themselves were unable to contain the effects of wine, that eventually are characterized as the losers. And you will remember how important in Alcibiades' speech, in Alcibiades' praise of Socrates, the motif of Socrates' moderation, not only in regards to wine but also to sex, how important this motif is.
Okay, so just two more points, and we'll keep these brief. I want to move forward to a later point in the text, at which the rather sober evening is vehemently disrupted. And what we have after Socrates has delivered an incredible speech, we seem to be reaching the end, all the participants have done their party show by now, we seem to be wrapping up. Everyone is applauding Socrates when suddenly there's a disruption. Suddenly into the room breaks a komos, a drunken band of individuals led by Alcibiades. Alcibiades is so drunk, he's staggering, he can barely be kept upright, he has to be propped up by one of his companions, and everyone turns to look at him. And Plato gives us several details about Alcibiades' appearance. He tells us that he's wearing a crown made up of violets and ivy, and that he's also got ribbons in his hair. And the violet is associated with Aphrodite, it is a flower of Eros. The violet is also associated with the muses. Alcibiades arrived in the guise of a poet. The ivy is, of course, the plant of Dionysus. Dionysus, the god of wine, the god of the symposium, also the god of the theatre. Now, there's a curious detail in the text. We hear that initially Alcibiades wishes to place the ribbons in his hair on the head of Agathon. But he then changes his mind, he takes them from Agathon and presents them to Socrates instead. Now, ribbons appear in practically every visual representation of victory, of the celebration of a victory. Because what the athletic and the musical victor received were ribbons or fillets. We have some wonderful vases showing athletes just covered in these things, hanging down from their body. Now, what exactly is going on in Plato's text? Why this detail of the wreath with ivy on it? Why is Alcibiades staggering? Okay, he's drunk. Why is he presenting ribbons? Well, in order to achieve elucidation, we need to look at what is being displayed on the screen right now. This is actually a Roman sculpted relief, but it's been argued that these types of reliefs, and there are many from Rome, actually draw on a practice in classical Greece, and that there may possibly have been some kind of Greek prototype. And in this, what we see, this figure here, is the figure of Dionysus. Dionysus, who is approaching a reclining symposias, someone who is at a banquet, who has raised his hand in greeting. There are indications of a very lavish setting, rich hangings, finely worked couch, the details are hard to see. What's also clear, if you look closely, is that Dionysus is staggering, as though he is drunk, and he's followed by his retinue of satyrs. Now, we have other images very like this. In some of them, there's a half-drunken Maenad being supported by other satyrs. We also, in these scenes, have indications of a dramatic victory. There will be the kinds of victory monuments in the background. winning producers of plays set up. You also see theatrical masks and other accessories of the theatre. What this is describing is a scene in which a victorious poet or victorious actor celebrates a victory banquet following his win in a dramatic festival. And in the imagination of our sculptors and perhaps artists as well, although we don't have evidence of that, Dionysus himself comes to participate in this victory banquet and to validate the fact that this poet has indeed won. And he presents this individual with the victory fillet, with the victory ribbons. Now, this is the role that Alcibiades is playing, arriving drunk, arriving half supported by his companions, and presenting the fillets, the ribbons, not to Agathon, who won in the dramatic competition, but to Socrates instead. Because the entire symposium, as Plato describes it, is set up as a reenactment of the whole dramatic event. In the theatre festival at the City Dionysia, where Agathon's victory was on another occasion, you had performances not just of tragedies, but of comedies and of so-called satyr plays, where satyrs, men dressed as satyrs, would be chorus. And each one of these was a competition. Now, in the Symposium of Plato, we have a comedy performed in the shape of Aristophanes' speech, the tragedian Agathon delivering his speech, a satyr play in the shape of Alcibiades, who arrives with his satyrs. But who is the victor, the one who is victorious here? Whose is the best speech? Well, Agathon and Socrates fight it out throughout the text. At one point, Agathon in fact says, Dionysus will have to be the judge between us. And on another occasion, Socrates accuses Agathon of trying to intimidate him by the glory of his speech, this individual who just carried off a victory before 30,000 men. What can poor Socrates do? There's a competition going on between them. Socrates wins, and he wins not only because he delivers the best speech, but because, as Professor De Angelis already said, he is literally the only man left standing. He drinks everyone else under the table. As we end the story, everyone but Socrates is asleep, absolutely prostrate. The last two, Agathon and Aristophanes, were passing the wine cup back and forth. They fell asleep, couldn't hold the wine anymore. Socrates is unmoved. He is impermeable. And this brings us to the final point that I want to make. We're going to skip that. We're going to look at one detail in the text, in Alcibiades' final speech, where he talks about Socrates and he compares him to an image. He's trying to come up with a way of describing, actually we could go back to that sector, trying to come up with a way of describing this individual who is so strange and so unique that he defies direct description. Instead, we have to use similes and metaphors to speak about him. Look at him, he says. Isn't he just like a statue of Silenus? You know the kind of statue I mean? You'll find them in any shop in town. Well, what our original Greek text actually says is you'll find them in any homemaker shops in town. Another recollection of those homes. It's a Silenus sitting, his flute or his pipes in his hands, and it's hollow. It's split right down the middle, and inside it's got tiny statues of the the gods, ugly on the surface, beautiful within. This is a trick image. It's a kind of Chinese box or Russian doll. You can think of this as a way of talking about this text itself, which is a series of Chinese boxes. You keep penetrating to the next level. But you also need to think about this idea of visual trickery. One thing on the outside, one thing on the inside. Visual games were played with all manner of symbotic objects. These potters were so skilled, they could use pressure and valves to create tricks. You could have some vessels that seemed to fill themselves, which had an internal cavity hidden from the viewer. Others where it was impossible to spill a drop. Some that played visual games with the viewer. Here we have what's known as a sictaire, a wine cooler. The jar of wine would be placed inside this. This would be filled with, surrounded with ice or cold water would be poured around it, and it would keep the wine cool. Now, when you filled this type of vessel up with wine, what would happen to those dolphins? They would literally be bobbing around in the liquid medium, and as you may recall, Homer calls the sea wine dark. So we have this kind of visual joke. And my point is very simply that Alcibiades is putting us in mind of these types of symphotic riddles. How can one thing look like another? But what's also crucial for our purposes is this idea of opening up, of penetration. Now, lots and lots of myths in the Greek repertoire tell us about frustrated lovers or lovers who've lost their beloved. They can't attain them because they're dead or they're missing or they're in love with someone else. So what do? They make an image of them. They try to consummate love with a marble image. The most famous story of all concerns a 4th century image made by the Athenian sculptor Praxiteles, who crafts an incredible image of Aphrodite, a marble Aphrodite. She's dedicated in a temple at Knidos, and supposedly a young man looks at this image and falls in love with this marble statue. And he's so enamored of it, he contrives to have himself shut up in the temple at night, tries to consummate the affair, of course can't penetrate the marble body, but we know that he tried because there is a stain on the thigh of the statue. In imagining Socrates as an image, Alcibiades is tapping into this notion of the impermeability of this figure. He cannot be moved. And so Alcibiades turns to violence. He says, isn't he just like the satyr Marsyas? Well, as you may know, Marsyas came to a very bad end. He was a flute player. He challenged Apollo, god of the lyre, to a competition. He, of course, lost the competition. The lyre always outmasters the flute. He was flayed for his pains. His skin was taken off. But where I want to leave you and hand things back the final time to Professor De Angelis is with the notion of Socrates as satyr, Socrates as flute player. It is the piping, the words of Socrates which lure Alcibiades on. He tells us he can't resist the music of Socrates. And remember that flute playing in 5th century Athens was regarded as a highly ambivalent activity. The well-born youth, and Plutarch tells us this about Alcibiades, doesn't want to play the flute. He says the lyre is for the well-born, not the flute. Why? Because the flute blocks the mouth. It blocks the mouth, it hinders the exercise of logos. More than that, what does it do to your face when you blow the flutes, the pipes, the double pipes that the Greeks played? say, it deforms your face, it puts you out of countenance, your cheeks are puffed up. And Greek flute players, in fact, wore a very curious piece of equipment, a leather strap around their cheeks to the back of their head to prevent full inflation. And what we're going to see now is precisely how Socrates looks like one of these flute-playing actors.
Yes, you've already had a glimpse of Socrates' face, because in the very same years in which Plato was writing the Symposium, Socrates' disciples decided to send up a portrait of him in the academy, and a portrait which is lost, which is known to us through Roman copies, one of which you see here, and where he is definitely portrayed as being ugly, bald-headed, with his broad, flat face, small eyes, crow's feet at the corners, there's numb nose. There's no doubt that Socrates that they're presenting Socrates as being ugly and as being similar to a satyr, a face of which you can see on this coin here. But what is remarkable is not the fact that Socrates was ugly, but that his disciples decided to represent him as such in a statue, because this was a blatant violation of the conventions that ruled self-representation of the Athenians in the wake of the art of the Parthenon, be they important politicians such as Pericles, or private persons such as this free burning man on a funerary monument. In each and every case, and have hundreds of them, they all have very even faces with symmetrical features, beautified faces, idealized faces. Again, you see how powerful the impact of the Parthenon had been in 5th and 4th century Athens. They still wanted to believe that they were able to live up to this ideal of perfection that they had invented around the mid-5th century. And against this background, Socrates is characterized explicitly as somebody who questions the traditional norms of the polis, of the city. Somebody who forces the interlocutor, or in this case, the viewer, to go beyond the surface of appearances. And he's connoted as being uncanny, unsettling, just as unsettling as the satyrs were. It has the same connotations that were used by the vase makers and by the vase painters to represent the faces of these strange wild beings that partake of the world of nature as well as the world of culture, and in which in some cases as on this face here are displayed on one side of the vase and address the user of the vase, inviting him to make out of the symposium something more than an occasion of drink, an occasion to drink and to get drunk. I think that's it.
Now, I want to thank our
Professors DeAngelis and Steiner. And this is a really interesting interweaving of philosophical, literary, and visual text. I think it's a wonderful example of how using visual materials really does open up a text in a different kind of way. The fact that we got the quotation from Thucydides and got to hear about the symposium is really astonishing. And I, for one, have thought a lot about the Parthenon. You know, I taught Art Hum before. And the extent to which that ties in with the symposium and the way that you brought out, is, I thought, was really, really very, very helpful. Now, we only have a couple of minutes. Why don't we take just a couple of questions? And I'm sure we can get to our lecturers to stand around and hang out for a few minutes and take other questions. So does anybody have a question for us right now? Do you have to stand up and shout? Or should we just talk quietly at the front here? So, quick questions? Yes, Pamela.
Was anyone else besides Socrates portrayed in this, ugly, uncanny way?
Was anybody, I'm repeating it for the recorder, was anybody other than Socrates represented in this ugly way? No. I mean, this is really an exception. You have hundreds of funerary stelae, such as the one I've just shown, and they all invariably portray both men and women with this idealized, beautiful features that we start seeing on the Parthenon.
Are there any representations of Aristodemus, or is he just not important enough?
No. Sorry. The question was, are there any representations of Aristodemus? No. He's just a hanger-on, and in fact, what's very clear from the text is that he models himself on Socrates in every way. He tries to replicate him, and if we had time today, it would have been interesting to go into that whole idea of mimesis and replication, and then also to think about the transformation of this verbal occasion into a written text, because Plato is also using the whole reification in the shape of the statue to think about that. Yeah.
On the Art Hum website, it has some images of cups with masks on the side, and it says that that the drinker would appear to be wearing a mask.
Yes.
Dionysus is the god of theater and of mask, because in drinking wine you experience also an alteration of your own self, and therefore enter into a different state. So these are very apposite divinity for this purpose. And the base painters use this. This aspect of Dionysus to decorate some of their cups, which have these big eyes on the exterior, so that when you lift the cup and bring it to your mouth, and your face is covered by the cup from which you're drinking, the other participants in the symposium don't see your own face anymore, but see this. This pain face, this mask, which is represented on the exterior of the cup. And so it is a way of visualizing this transformation of identity, which is induced by wine.
No, not necessarily. Xenophon wrote a symposium, and at the end of that, and that's filled with erotic titillation as well, all the men are supposed to go off and speak with their wives. So that wasn't necessarily a second best. At different stages, but it also was, together with the gymnasium, the symposium was perhaps the chief area where pederastic relations were pursued.
Yes.
last questions? All right, so thank you for coming, and I really, really, really want to thank Professor Steiner and DeAngelis.